Starting at verse 31. Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my mother and my brothers?" he asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother." This is the word of the Lord. Brothers and sisters in Jesus, many of us, I think, want to know what God's will is. We talk about that actually quite often as Christians. We want to know, what is God's will for my life? Sometimes it's in those little everyday sorts of things. What is God's will for me today? How does he want me to live my life today? What does he want me to spend my time on this week? But often it's bigger questions where this really comes to the surface. Is it time for me to retire? Or does God want me to stay working for a little while longer? Is it God's will that I take a new job with another company and leave behind a career I've had for a long time? Is it God's will that I move in with or move my parents in with me so that I can take care of them as they grow older? Or is that not what his will would be? If you think back 20, 30, 40 years or more, is it God's will that I marry this person or not? What is God's will for me? We talk about that, and we actually are, many of us probably serious about seeking and doing God's will. We pray for it. We want to know what it is, but I don't know about you, but sometimes it's never quite as clear as we'd like it. I mean, wouldn't it be great if you could just go and look up at the sky and you could see the answers written in plain language right there. Here's what God's will is for you. But we all know it doesn't work like that. God's will often seems to us hidden. It might seem mysterious. It might seem unknown to us. So we make decisions and we might say, well, I think I'm doing God's will here, but sure. We want to do God's will. How do we know what that is? How can we make that decision? Jesus is speaking to us here in this passage about what it means to do God's will. He's talking to us about doing, how we can know, how we can practice God's will in daily life. But what struck me about this passage, and what I think is so key here, is that Jesus makes that connection to who we are as a family of God. In other words, Jesus wants us to see that doing God's will flows out of our identity as members of God's family. So we need to first know who we are, and then we can talk together and reflect on how do we then live, how do we learn God's will, and then we can talk about how do we pray for that. So, who we are, how we then live, and how to pray for it. I don't know if you've ever been embarrassed by a family member. You don't have to admit to it right here. You don't have to admit to it right now. My daughter is nodding her head very vigorously, so it's probably me that has embarrassed her. But you've had that before, right? A family member says something or does something in a way very publicly, and you just sort of wish not have that family tie in that moment. Or maybe you've been the one and you know that your actions have embarrassed other members of your family. And I don't know how you handle it, what you do in a situation like that, but this is a story where, surprisingly, Jesus is the one who is bringing embarrassment on his family. We didn't read it tonight, but if you have your Bible still open, you can look back at verse 21. Jesus is teaching, he's speaking, he's drawing a lot of attention, the crowds are coming to him, and his family hears about this and they go to take charge of him, for they said he is out of his mind. here's Mary, here's Jesus' brothers and sisters, and they have a family conference, and they say, you know, we've got to do something about Jesus, because he's saying all these things, and people are beginning to talk about us behind our back. We really have to just pull him in, get him some time just by ourselves, maybe take a retreat off by the lake or something, get him to clear his head. We need him to stop acting like this, because he's embarrassing us. He's embarrassing himself. And by the time we get to verse 31, we read that Jesus' mother and his brothers and his sisters arrive, and they're about ready to put their plan into action. So they send a messenger into the house. Maybe the house was packed full of people. His mother and brothers couldn't get in. So they give word. They say, hey, would you please go tell Jesus that we're out here, and we really just need to talk to him, and we're going to try to put a stop to this. So word comes to Jesus, and you read, there's a moment of suspense there in verse 32. The crowd is sitting all around, and they're wondering, how is Jesus going to handle this? What is he going to say? Is he going to maintain his loyalty to his earth family, to his immediate family, by saying, okay, I better leave you all behind here, and maybe I'll come back and finish my teaching another time, but I'll better go with my family? Or will he reject his family and stay with the crowds, right? So the pregnant pause here, what is Jesus going to do? Where will his loyalties lie? And what Jesus does, it's surprising. He doesn't, in a sense, he does neither of those. He doesn't denounce his family, but he doesn't embrace them in the moment either. What he does is he redefines what family really is. In verse 34, Jesus looks around at the crowd, at all the people listening to them, and he says, you need to see that you are my family if you do the will of my Father. In other words, Jesus redefines family as those who do the will of God. Family is no longer primarily defined by your birth relationship with people, by blood relationship. Family is defined by your relationship to God. Now Jesus, and there's another place in Scripture where Jesus even takes this further. You might be familiar with it. It's one of these hard to grasp verses in the New Testament where Jesus actually says, if anyone does not hate his mother or father or brothers and sisters, he cannot be my disciple. You remember hearing that? And we think to ourselves, how can Jesus say that? Is Jesus really asking us to sever all ties with our immediate family so that we can belong to his family? And the answer is, well, no, that's not quite what Jesus has in mind. When Jesus says you need to be ready and willing to hate your brother, mother, father, sisters, he's actually saying that your commitment and loyalty to me has to be so great that your loyalty to your birth family, your biological family, looks like hatred in comparison. I can say that, and that in some ways helps a little bit, but I don't want us to soften that too much either. Jesus is asking an awful lot of us. We can say, we wonder, how does Jesus ask us to seemingly minimize our ties to our family? Well, think of this for a moment. One of the reasons that this text seems very offensive to us is because most of us have probably been part of healthy, fairly good families. We've been raised by parents who, in general, they weren't perfect, but in general, they provided for our needs. They took care of us when we were discouraged or sad as little kids. They wrapped their arms around us, hopefully, and sort of cared for us. Or they made sure that we always had enough food to eat and clothes to wear and a home to live in. And so if you're part of a family like that, then it's hard to understand why Jesus would say you need to leave your family behind. But here's the thing. If you probe a little deeper on this, you begin to realize that the true family, the heart of what a family really is not really formed by biological ties. Just imagine for a moment a child born into a family that abandons her at a very young age. And so this child grows up and maybe moves from foster home to foster home and really never develops a permanent family to call her own. And maybe she comes to the age of 20, and lo and behold, her biological parents show up. Now, you can imagine, and it wouldn't be so far-fetched to hear her say, you know what, those people are really strangers to me. They're not really family. Yeah, they're biological, but they're not family. Because your family, the essence of what family really is, are the people who have been, who've gone through the fires of life with you. Right? Real family is forged by the relationships you develop as you face adversity together, as you cry together, as you rejoice together. Right? Real family is formed as you experience triumph in life and as you walk through defeat together, as you love each other. That's where family, that's the crucible in which real family is formed. And so what Jesus is actually saying here is, I have a family for anyone who has ever felt like they might be on the outside. I have a true and greater family that you can belong to. He's saying that the disciples of Jesus are formed, or the family of Jesus is made up of those people who are committed to going through the adversity of life together. The people who are committed to God and to obeying and following Him, walking alongside of one another. So for people, you can imagine, for people who maybe are fatherless or who otherwise have no family, God says, I have room in my family for you. You can belong to my family. And furthermore, this is good news for all of us because, I mean, your families, hopefully growing up, were reasonably good and healthy families, but no matter how good your family was, it wasn't perfect. Your parents weren't always there for you the way that you wanted. They let you down. Maybe they didn't nurture you the way they wanted. Maybe your father was too critical or your mom didn't show affection to you, whatever it might be. And what this says is that you have a true father, a true and perfect parent who will never let you down, who will never fail you, who will never stop loving you. You have the Father in God that you long for and that you need. In fact, God is the perfect parent who cares for you all the way to death. And it's at the expense of death that God can say to us, my son lost his place in the family so that you can belong to my family. That's what Jesus is getting at here. That's God's mission, is creating this new and perfect family in which we find our true home. And when you find your place in this family, when we begin to see our identity as a member of God's family, that's when we can begin to understand and reflect together on what does it mean then to do, to seek and to do the will of God. There are a number of places in the Bible where Jesus uses very personal titles for us. He calls us in different places friends. He calls us children. He calls us siblings, right? Very personal, very deeply seated relationships that Jesus says, this is what our relationship is like. But every time Jesus says something like that, every time he calls us a brother or a sister or a friend, he then goes on to say, if you do the will of the Father, or if you hear and obey my teaching, or if you do what I command. In other words, Jesus, he says that your relationship with me then leads to you living in obedience to me. Our identity as friends and family members of Jesus leads to us obeying him. Now this is actually fairly easy to make sense of, right? Family, your family has a certain way of doing things. You've got customs and traditions. You've got rules that you abide by. You've got certain ways that you just do everyday life. Your family has a culture all of its own. And Jesus is really saying that doing God's will means learning to live as a member of God's household. It means learning to live how God wants his family to live. It's not just the rules that we might say, but it's also the way of thinking and understanding things. It's also the way we look at the world around us. So doing God's will means that we learn what it is to be a part of this household. I'll give you a little story. I think I may have told this story once before, but it's a story that made an impression on me. It was when I was working at Bethany Christian Services in Grand Rapids. You may have heard of them. Bethany does a lot of international adoption work. They bring children from countries all over the world who want to be adopted or to families that want to adopt them. And I remember on this occasion, I was standing in the lobby of their Grand Rapids office. I was waiting, I think, to get picked up. I think Amy had to come and pick me up or something. So I was had about 15 minutes. I was just kind of standing there waiting. And about a stone's throw away from me, they were, I don't know that they saw me, or if they did, they weren't too worried about me overhearing. I wasn't eavesdropping, but it was just close enough that I could hear them. And it was a teenage girl. It looked like she was maybe 15, 16 years old. And I could hear she was really frustrated. She was saying, you know, and I could gather that she'd been adopted from another country into a family here in the United States. And she says, you know, my family, my parents have all these rules that I have to follow. They have a curfew. I have to call them if I'm going to be, you know, past such and such a time. And I'm not allowed to go out with my friends and, you know, all night long. And I have to be home at a certain time. She says, this just doesn't seem right. It doesn't seem fair. And the person that she was talking to, I assume it was a social worker, she says, well, now wait a minute. She says, these are your parents. This is your home. And you may not like all the rules that you have to live by, but you have to learn the rules of your home and of your family. You have to follow them because they're there for your good. They're there for your benefit. I think that's really true for Christian living. We can think of it as just learning a set of rules, but you also, I think the better way to think of it is we've been adopted into this family. We're part of a family that God has created at infinite expense unto himself. Now he wants us to learn to live as a member of his family so that we will flourish. Now let's get a little more specific. When we talk about what does it mean to do God's will in the context of our family? What does that mean to obey God's will? I think it's helpful to recognize that idea of God's will can have really two meanings, and both are important. So when we talk about, I want to do God's will, two meanings to that. The first is maybe the more important one. The first is what's sometimes called God's decreed will. It's what God spells out for us in his word, right? God tells us his will. We read it many times in the letters of Paul, where God says, it's my will that you be free from sexual immorality, that you not slander, that you don't use coarse language with one another. It's God's will that we learn to be generous. There are all kinds of things that God tells us fairly explicitly in his word. And so when we think about God's will, probably the most important thing is that we recognize doing God's will means that we learn to obey him, that we learn to live by what he has told us in his word. Now I think in here is where it also helps to have family, church family around us, because church family helps us understand God's word. Church family can encourage us when we maybe are struggling to do God's will. We may know what it is, but we may be sort of having that tendency to not want to do it. Well, your church family can say, hey, you know what? It's God's will that we do this. God doesn't want us doing this or that. Right? So God's will is spelled out for us here, and the family of God can help us know and understand and apply that. But then there's God's, sort of his everyday will, and this might be what we are more talking about when we say, you know, I don't know what God's will is for my life, right? We usually mean those big questions, those decisions we have to make. Right? The time for me to retire, the time to take this job or that job, what school should I go to, what should I study, who should I marry, right? I say, I don't know what God's will is. And it's frustrating because sometimes we treat it, we approach it as sort of, you know, doorway one or doorway two, and which one is it? And if you make the wrong choice, you know, too bad, right? I mean, that's sort of how we sometimes worry that it might be. And we want to know God's will, And it's not always as clear to us as we'd like it to be. Now, you can read the Bible all day long. You can read it cover to cover. And you will not find in there, should I move my parents into our house so I can take care of them? You won't find the answer to that there. Or you can read the Bible cover to cover, and it's not going to tell you, should I take this job or should I turn it down? Or you can read the Bible cover to cover and it won't tell you, is it God's will that I retire now or wait a couple more years? Right? These everyday sorts of decisions, it's not that God leaves them up to us to figure out on our own. It's just that he doesn't explicitly tell us. And so then how do you know what God's will is? Well, here's the thing. God gives us principles in here. Again, that first category of God's will helps us. There are some principles, there are some very key things that God lays out for us. God wants us, for example, to honor our parents. Now, does that mean every time we have to move them into our house and take care of them? No, it doesn't mean that. But the principle is there, and so we have to say, well, how can I honor my parents? And then pray about it, and talk to other people in the Christian community, the Christian family, and you learn to then make decisions as best you can. I mean, it's not always that you come to the point where you say, I know 100% that this is absolutely what God wants me to do, but you sometimes say, well, I've studied the scripture, I've talked to people, I think this is where God is leading me, and you make that decision and you move forward and you trust that you are doing God's will. And the beautiful thing is that God's word tells us that it's the Spirit of God who is living in us that shapes our thinking and shapes our understanding as we read his word and as we talk to people and as we ponder with one another and talk, try to weigh out what does God want us to do. The Spirit of God is living in us, helping us to make these decisions. And so we have that assurance we can trust and depend on the Spirit to do his work in our hearts and in our minds. Even if we don't always have the sense, I know 110% this is absolutely the right thing, we can make the decisions trusting the Spirit is working in us. Now, how do we pray about all of this? Well, I like how the Catechism really draws together some of that family language here. You notice the Catechism says, we have to be praying that we learn to do God's will without any back talk. Send that to your kids, right? Don't talk back to me. Here's what I want from you. Now, don't argue with me. Don't try to tell me that I'm wrong. Learn to do my will. And ideally, you want your kids to do it readily and cheerfully and willingly. You want ultimately your kids, their will, to match your will. Right? I mean, you remember what that's like. You want them to do what you want them to do quickly, gladly, joyfully, trusting in you. Well, that carries over, doesn't it? God wants us to pray daily, often, that the way we live our lives will be perfectly in line with his will, that we're not doing it grudgingly, that we're not saying, okay, God wants me to, not gossip about people and, it's fun to gossip, but I guess I won't. No, God wants us to say, this is really, I trust that this is the best will that God has for me. And we do it willingly. Or God wants us to be generous. Right? And we don't say, well, I guess I should give more money or I should be generous with my money to the poor. No, God wants us to be willing and eager to do his will without back talk. And the other thing that, that strikes me in this is that the way the Catechism reminds us that God's will is done perfectly in heaven. Right? God's will is done as quickly and obediently as the angels themselves are obeying God. Now, I haven't given much thought to that before, but here the Catechism is reminding us is that heaven is a place where God's will is carried out perfectly day in and day out. The angels are quick to obey God. They do it willingly. They do it joyfully. Now, when we pray then, when we make it a habit of praying that we would do God's will, we're actually praying that a little bit of heaven would come here to earth. We're praying that a little corner of heaven, if you will, is being realized here in our life. We're praying that heaven would come down to us. So it's not just about, well, what do I have to do? Which decision should I make? It's, Lord, let me be so willing and submissive to you that it's heaven on earth. So we pray, and we can then seek that obedience in our own life. Now, I thought I would close by sharing that probably the story where, for our family anyway, seeking God's will was one of the most, not difficult things, but it was the most obvious things we were trying to do and we wrestled with. And that was when, in fact, it was 9 years ago Friday that we moved here. And that decision, do we come here or where, we had three calls at the time, and all three of them had, their strengths and things that we looked at and said, well, I don't know if that will work so well. And, it was one of those things where we wish we could have just gone outside and saw it clearly written in the sky, right? But of course, it doesn't work like that. And so what did we do? Well, we prayed about it an awful lot. We talked about it with a lot of people whose opinion really mattered to us and who we trusted. And then we looked sort of the common sense things. We looked, okay, what are my strengths as pastorally, and what is this church looking for, and what is that church looking for, and, you know, we weighed it all out, and then we had to make the decision, trust it, to move forward in faith. We got to the point where we said, we think this is where God is leading us, discipling. Now, at the time, did we know 100% guaranteed? Yes, absolutely. Well, no, we didn't. We were moving forward in faith, trusting that God had been working through the whole process. Now, we look back and we say, God has blessed that, at least from our point of view, and we trust that it's mutual. But we see that obedience to God's will, it comes through learning to trust, learning to depend on Him, learning to do His will as we go. So we are members of God's family. We can trust that His Spirit is working among His family to help us know His will and to obey it. Let's seek God's will. Let's seek heaven on earth. Let's seek to be willing and obedient to God in all things. Let's pray together. Lord, we want to be obedient to You. We want to do Your will. Sometimes it's easier to know that than others. Sometimes it's pretty clear how You want us to live. But then there are those times where we have to make decisions where it's not so easily spelled out. And it's then that we need wisdom, and we need to trust that Your Spirit is working and moving among us. Help us to remember that as children in Your family, no wrong decision that we might make ever means that we lose our place in Your family. And help us to know that as Your children, You've given us everything we need to do Your will. Help us to joyfully and gladly seek obedience to You. In Jesus' name, amen.